Good evening and welcome to this edition of The Checkpoint. My name is Nicholas Wasaja. Thank you very much for keeping it Urban TV. We hope while out there you're wearing your mask, your social distancing, and you're sanitizing because COVID-19 is still ravaging our society. Now, my guest tonight is a coffee specialist, impact investor, and business leadership coach with over 20 years of business leadership experience. He is a practicing entrepreneur, co-owning and running enterprises in commodity knowledge consulting, trading, enterprise development and management, and real estate development. He is the co-founder and CEO of the Africa Coffee Academy, executive director of Ashland Motors Africa Limited, chairman of Bridge Credit Finance, and a consultant with the World Bank in commodity risk management. He currently serves on several boards, governing councils and trusts, including Deje University, World Class Team Limited, Bugandaland Board, and Greenhill Academy. My guest tonight is a Rotarian and past Rotary District Governor for District 9211. He is many things, but above all, the second Deputy Katikkiro of Buganda Kingdom and Minister for Finance, Investment, Planning and Economic Development in the Kingdom of Mwanika, Owekitiibwa Robert Waggwa Nsibirwa. Welcome to The Checkpoint.
Thank you very much, Mr. Wasaja, and I would like to say I salute all our viewers, and I'm happy to be in this seat to speak to you directly and also through the Urban TV.
We share a platform both as servants of Buganda Kingdom. I represent young people in the Great Luchiko, and unfortunately, I also sit on your finance committee. But before we delve into the kingdom matters, as a business expert, as an economist and statistician, I would want you to help my viewer understand what exactly has been, in your assessment, the impact of COVID-19 on business in Uganda. Why I'm asking is because Uganda's economy, when you look at its setup, in as much as the infections of COVID-19 haven't affected us as the rest of the world when it comes to health, the health bit, we certainly are going to have issues with our economy. And we depend on the global world that has been adversely affected. We trade much with China, with the Asian tigers, with Europe. So in your assessment, how has Uganda's economy been impacted on, or how do you project will be affected, especially in this second lockdown?
Thank you very much, Mr. Wasaja. I think the second lockdown, the effects on the economy, both at macro level and micro level, is going to be more severe than the first lockdown. Why? In the first lockdown, enterprises were running. So we had cash flow and we had some reserves. And when we had the first lockdown, we were able to use those cash flows and reserves to try and stay afloat. And when they opened up, we were trying to get up. But some sectors were more affected in the first lockdown than others. We know the education sector, the tourism sector, or what they call leisure, tourism and hotels and all that, they were really, really affected. And even manufacturing suffered a bit. So when they opened up, we're trying now to start again. I happen to chair a board of a school. I have friends who run leisure and tourist industry. So we have been trying to come back. Then the second lockdown, because we are not recovered or gained momentum during the first lockdown, the second lockdown is even more severe in terms of having a business running. And you know, in every challenge, there is a silver lining. There are those few sectors that have thrived during this lockdown. I'm sure the health industry, has thrived. I'm sure, you know, the pharmacies and all that. Agriculture has been affected, but not adversely as other sectors. I run a few enterprises. One of it is agriculture coffee. We have continued in the first and second lockdown to continue to procure coffee, process it, and export it. And you learned last month we exported almost 600,000 bags of coffee. There, that sector, what has happened is the delay. We have delays in getting the documentation in. We have those delays. And the other challenge you have been having are the containers. Because the importation into the country has almost gone down by 80%, the containers for exports are a challenge. So that's the only challenge there. But when you look at schools, for almost 2 years they have been closed. When you look at the hotels, give or take another 1.5 years, and all the allied industries with the leisure and entertainment industry. But when you look at the other service industries like bars and entertainment and saloons, it's been tough. And you know, I was talking to a government official about education institutions. The people in school are over 10 million from kindergarten to tertiary institutions. 10 million. Now, these drive our economy in terms of consumption. So if you are selling shoes for school children, uniforms, food, you know, soap, everything. When the children are going back to school, you go and shop if you have 5 children and you can fill a truck, you know. So all the factories that have been used to getting this cash flow, the economy on Nkrumah Road every January, December, November, January, May, is closed because this is the biggest consumption and they have effective demand. They buy. They buy paper, they buy food, they buy all those things. So there has been a ripple effect there. Because if you have 10 million people not consuming, including power, including water, and they are supposed to drive the manufacturing, then there's a ripple effect. I know somebody who brings paper from India. He has not been doing that. I know people have been living off the schools. You just say, I'll make so much money from November to January, and it will take me through another 3 months. So it's tough, and people have lost jobs. People have lost jobs. The few that have jobs have their salary halved. Others are getting 25%. Others have been allowed to go on leave without pay. And all this reduces demand in the economy. And when you reduce demand in the economy, everything goes down.
But what does this say about the nature of our economy? The newly appointed permanent secretary in the Ministry of Finance, Dr. Ramadan Gobi, calls it small money's economy, where we trade in chapati, boda boda, saloon, small money's going around. And juxtaposing that with what the president said, he said there is what we call the real economy, and in Uganda the real economy largely depends on health, education, and then agriculture. Now, if we are crippled in the other economy that has been crippled, but it is small, and then yet we are not making any serious strides in the real economy, what does that say about the nature of our economy?
I think one of the blessings we have, and sometimes when I'm giving talks to young people like you, I think it's a curse, is because we have food. You know, when you have food, and 70% of the people live in the village, and they wake up, they don't have to go to a supermarket to buy anything, but they can survive for a week because they have cassava, they have sweet potato, they have matoke, they have dodo, they can have sauce and food for a week. That's a blessing. That has been the main blessing to this government, that the majority of the people in the countryside are not starving. If we are Kenya, or if we are Zimbabwe, where they have national silos, we are the only country which doesn't have a food policy, you know, a national food policy, because most countries have that because food security policy. They have national silos where they keep grain. We don't have that. We assume everybody in his home will manage his food issues. So that has been, we have been lucky in that. And people drive to the villages, come back with food. But the guys in urban and peri-urban areas have got the most brunt because their gardens are in the shops and supermarkets. So they have to buy the food and pay for your car. A guy in the village will eat at 6 and sleep when he doesn't have light. So that has been a blessing. But the real economy in the CBD, 70 kilometers in the radius of Kampala, has suffered. And it is not a very big economy and it's not very resilient. I'll give you an example. Banks. If you look at banks, the portfolio at risk has moved in double digits. It's reached 20s, threatening 30s in some banks. Because if somebody borrowed to build a mall or a school or a hotel, they are not able to pay because they have no income. So that has a ripple effect. Then they have to classify this or write off, and they are making undue losses. When you look at the other industry like insurance, you can't think of doing insurance when you have to survive first, when you are not moving, when you say, well, I'll pray my bill doesn't get burnt by this cash flow. So because of that, everything is suffering. And when the government in the first lockdown pumped in about 4 trillion to support the economy in COVID, I think it was a good gesture. But the what was okay, the money came, but we are not able up to now to establish how that money was used to support the business sector. I was giving an example. We run businesses, we have loans, we have been paying tax. And the bank is only going to reduce the interest. The best they could do was to reschedule. A school is a public good. Education and health and security are supposed to be provided by the state. So somebody who comes in this space ought to be supported, you know. But again, you'd have said, okay, all schools, all education institutions that have been paying tax for the last 5 years, and URA can verify, should go to UDB and have their loan moved from 21% to 12%. Those kind of things are very effective and strong. But I think we missed an opportunity to support the industries that are supporting the economy to have real chance of coming up very, very quickly on the way we gave out that money. Some people gave that money to companies that were only 6 months old. Then we were given money to institutions to build maybe malls or apartments. So how are those going to support the economy? That was the challenge. And I hope the new team, the new cabinet can see really that they need to impact on the vehicles of resilience and catalyst in the economy, other than consumption. I think most of money went into consumption. And you have seen some buildings going much faster during the lockdown than during the normal time.
When you talk about resilience, I imagine you're envisioning an economy beyond government support, injecting stimulus packages, and you've ably explained what can be done to ensure that you resuscitate the economy. But beyond COVID-19, what do you think can be done to build a resilient economy that will be able to withstand such shocks? For example, COVID-19.
Everybody, including the international world, nobody had the blueprint. Every economy has suffered, including China. Other economies, because of their size and because of their... Uganda, we are corporate world since about 25 years. When I was at school, high school, there was hardly any private sector company. All were owned by government or by government and another entity. So we are a young corporate world, half a quarter century. Those guys have been a corporate world for 200 years. So they are more resilient, they, you know, the way they think and the way they work. But what I think government needs to look at micro things at the macro level and be true. You know, we have a lot of money spent in consumption. And this, I'm not a politician, and I don't want to go there. But as an economist and a statistician, there are people who don't produce that are assured of salary, even in the lockdown, 100%. You know, the politicians, the local administrators, and all that group, they get 100% their pay. Then somebody who is working in the private sector is told you are going to get 25%. And is the one who's most taxed, he's the one who is supporting this heavy consumption. I think we need to have a frank talk about public consumption vis-a-vis program consumption. You know, because it's not sustainable. We keep on increasing the layer and the support base keeps on getting squeezed out. And I'm seeing, for example, people have stopped importing things. And they pay the tax. People are not going to stop borrowing, but they're paying the interest rates and the government gets money in the tax. So what needs to be done is government to focus on areas that promote production, not consumption. So when there's more production, the cake is bigger and they can enjoy the luxury they want. But right now, the guy who has been shouldering this public debt and public consumption is being told, yes, we have locked down, yes, your business is in your knees, but we need more taxes to support the advisors, to support the ministers, to support all that referia. And I don't think it's sustainable. We are going to crash.
It's not sustainable, but when you look at the new tax regime vis-a-vis what you're proposing, are you satisfied that that's a direction that we are about to take, or it's still a long way to go?
You see, I'm an entrepreneur. So I want to choose how to spend my money and where to spend my money. But I'm in the country, so I have to pay taxes. I don't believe either a financial expert or a public finance expert that high taxes increase revenue. No. So taxes have been increased, you know, practically across the board. What it does, people find ways of dodging tax. There is an inverse relationship between high tax and rates and collection. Why don't you set rates that people can afford? And you have more people complying than saying, okay, we know petroleum people will pay, the banks will pay, the telecom companies will pay, let's get the maximum out of them. Now, and then the other guys who are freed will not want to come into the tax administration. But there has to be a balance between the rate so that you can have a bigger base. We have a lot of informal sector that you could encourage to join. Say, you know, whether you are in the saloon and run a saloon, you are going to pay 10% of your income. Maybe they will come in the bracket. But when you are in 35, then all that, you guys who are employed, you know, you are paying almost 40% from your income. Then people find a way of not paying all the money because they have to survive. So there has to be a balance, and sometimes you find maybe people are lazy. They just want to correct what is straightforward, but it kills the industry and you lose more. We have the lowest tax collection to GDP ratio. We are only second to Burundi in East African Community, in the Great Lakes. You know, we are about 13-14%. Other countries are 20. And also the reluctance, because people who run the economy know people who don't pay tax. They know people who don't pay tax because if I'm importing fuel from the same source and I'm selling it at 5,000 and you're selling it at 3,000, what's your magic?
The indicator is that you're hiding figures.
If we buy rice from Pakistan and I'm selling a kilo at 25,000, you're selling it at 15,000, I'm paying tax. And they know, but as it is, it's whom you know and it's who you are. Which is somebody has to come. If everybody was paying tax, it would be at 20%. There would be less pain. But some people don't pay tax. And people collect tax, know them. But they don't have the will and the strength to bring them to book. And that's the challenge.
In the 2008 recession, the global recess, what countries that US did was to say, Ford, look here, we cannot afford your company folding simply because we are in a recess. And government did step up and said, we have to invest massively in these companies because at the end of the day, they employ people. And if they do employ people, that pushes our purchasing power up. Do you see us taking that direction in the event of things, or we are still at everyone for themselves and God for us all?
I think the only sector this government will intervene will be banks. I think they wouldn't allow banks to fail en masse, but I don't see them trying to save Ashland Motors Africa, my motor company, or my coffee company. I don't see them doing that. We have to fend for ourselves. I think the financial sector, the banks, they wouldn't allow that to happen. I think they'll find a way of intervening.
Unfortunately, you have a foreign banking sector.
Yes, and we have some one or two Ugandans banks. But I don't see them coming to camp and say, you guys, you have been paying so much tax for over 20 years. We can't allow you to get up. Oh, you guys, you employ so many people. We are going to pump in another trillion. I don't see that happening. Because in the first lockdown, when the 4 trillion went, they would have targeted people who are the highest taxpayers who are struggling. Because the books are there, the loans they have, the employees they have, and you say, no. New Vision Group, you are not going to close. You are employing 10,000 people. And with 10,000 people with an average family of six in Uganda, those are so many people. No, you can't fail. I'm sure, I know for certain, every company is on its own.
OHT, if you say everyone is on their own, that raises a red flag. But now, bringing it down to Omuntu-wa-wansi, because be it as it may, we must survive as human beings. If I've been surviving on trading in Chikubo or riding a boda-boda and there is no hope for government support, then that means I have to fend for myself. How do you, as a business consultant, advise that people, the wananchi, are able to dust themselves off and be up on their feet once this pandemic is over? Because certainly it will.
I've been giving talks about resilience. And I've been telling young people especially that let us look at the opportunities the lockdown has brought. I've just had a haircut. You came in when I was just doing a haircut. I told my barber, this is a time to make a lot of money, actually. I told you to buy a motorcycle, you refused. Now you can't even ride a motorcycle. Get a bicycle. Ride it to your top 10 customers. I was paying 15,000 to go to a saloon. When you come here, I'll give you 50,000. You know? And I know, and I mentioned the people who go to that saloon. So it's finding people where they are. I was telling market people, vendors in Kabaka's market, when I was talking to them, you should keep the list of people who are buying matoke, tomatoes from you. Call them and say, Nyabo, is your banana finished? Yeah, but I can't come. I have no sticker to travel. No, then you say, I'm sending a boda-boda guy. Pay him when he has reached at your home. A boda-boda guy you trust. We all have that boda-boda guy we trust. So you have to just think outside the box, and you can still survive because people still have needs. So if you are in a supermarket, people, many have gone online. There are people buying things online and having the Boda people deliver. The people have been in the saloons. You can walk if you can. You can ride a bicycle if you can. You can learn how to ride a motorcycle and rent it for a day. And if the money is going to make sense. So we just have to find a way to survive by meeting the needs of people in the convenience that lockdown doesn't give them. So, and there are some people who have really made money. There are people, I have a young lady who sells coffee, roasted coffee. She tells me she's making more money than when the lockdown is on there because she's delivering on a motorcycle. Get the motorcycle, the guy that she's contracting all her customers, you know. So there are opportunities that we can take. The guys who are singing and who are running bars have to find something else to do until things open. You know, they can't sing anymore. I don't know how YouTube works and all that. Maybe they can do that, but for people who are trading, you can find a way to continue trading, not 100% or even not 50%, but at 40% or 30 to survive. And we have been encouraging people quietly, openly, and otherwise to find something they can do that people are willing to pay for in this lockdown.
Perfect. You see, when a house is burning and it's a storied building, most people do not succumb to actually the fire. Most people succumb to fear when they think that the only solution is to jump high and escape the fire. But if someone is out there and they can tell them that you can take the stairs, there is no fire there, they can probably survive. That then poses the question, how do you, grandeur institutions like Buganda Kingdom, like the Church, Church of Uganda, the Catholic Church, how do they then step in to be able to pat these guys that have been battered on the shoulder and tell them, we can take this route. It might be a longer route, but we shall be able to survive.
Buganda Kingdom, when we had the first lockdown, we grouped as the Minister in Charge of Planning and also Economic Development and Finance. We quickly had a forum which we called Buganda Kingdom Leadership Business Continuity Plan. And we had talks and coaching, first of all, with the leaders, Masaza leaders, Magombola leaders, chairmen of boards. We have about 33 companies and organizations in the kingdom, and the CEOs. And for about 12 weeks, we got different people to speak to them on how the business can continue. And each of them had a business continuity plan, including the ministries. Each ministry, each minister had a business continuity plan. How does the kingdom continue? How does the entities continue? And how can the leaders at all levels in the kingdom support the people to continue with their lives? And that was very helpful. So we were on radio, we were on social media, we were on TV, trying to explain what people can do to continue and stay open. And I'm happy, even at the second lockdown, apart from the institutions that they have allowed to close completely, like education institutions, all our organizations are open. And we don't have any part of the country that's starving. In the first lockdown, we were able even to give resources and food quietly. We still do to people who are in vulnerable states. People are vulnerable. Not the poor, but people are vulnerable. But the issue which is sustainable is to empower those people on how they can survive. We do that. And the second lockdown has been more challenging. It has been more challenging because it found everybody trying to recover. And then there was this slump. And we hope they can open in the next 12 days. But we're encouraging people, because the markets are open and a few other things, we're encouraging them to look for opportunities in this adversity, because they are there. And we take chance even to point them out where we can and show them and encourage them and support them. So The leadership, I can't talk for the church. I'm only a follower in my church.
Well, I'm thinking about institutions in general,
the kingdom has been able to reach out to its people, to its staff, in the organization, to its leaders, and they have done what they can do. We have told them to even share what the little they have. If we hear some of the programs on our media platforms, you hear people saying, reach out to your friends. If somebody can't pay rent, give them a desk. If somebody can't have a meal and you can afford, give them something to eat. And it's resonating. But there are groups, yesterday I had a reach out from the singers. They said we are really, really struggling. And we are trying to see what we can do. But most of the time we do things quietly for different reasons. But yes, we are the kingdom. I know we have a plan. We have a COVID task force led by the first deputy katikiro, Professor Twaha Chigonkawase, that is trying to see where the most vulnerable people, first within the kingdom leadership and staff, and then the wider kingdom. And we have bi-weekly meetings to address those gaps.
So you by and large are saying all the other institutions can borrow a leaf from you. But before
I'm sure they're also doing something. I want to believe my Anglican church, my Bishop of Namirembe, I'm sure it is finds a way of looking after his reverence.
Okay, Owechiwa, we are going to go for a very short break, but when we return, we shall talk more about the monarch. Let's break.